Welcome, dear listeners, to the Carolina Haynes Podcast, brought to you by Wreak Havoc Productions and A Darker World. I'm your host, Dan Sellers. The devil went down to Georgia. For the residents of Elberton, Georgia, that phrase is more than just a title of a popular song by Charlie Daniels. Elberton is the home of the Georgia Guidestones. The devil went down to Georgia, the song says. He was looking for a soul to steal. Ironically, just a couple of months after the song was released in the summer of 1979, a man calling himself Robert C. Christian walked into the office of the Elberton Granite Finishing Company. The man was very open about the fact that his name was not really Robert C. Christian. He explained that he represented a small group of loyal Americans and that they, and he, preferred to remain anonymous. He said they wished to purchase 250,000 tons of granite to be erected as a monument just outside of town. The granite company employee must not have trusted Christian very much because he gave him a quote several times higher than their normal rate, hoping the man would take his business elsewhere. But he didn't. He didn't even blink. He immediately paid the jacked up price and handed the man a case. Inside the case was a model of the monument and 10 pages of detailed specifications. 9 months later, on March 22, 1980, the Georgia Guidestones were unveiled. While not nearly as grand in scale, the Georgia Guidestones have been referred to as America's Stonehenge. In fact, they're almost twice the height of their more famous British cousin. The structure is comprised of 9 huge granite slabs, a center column 5 meters high by 1 meter wide and 0.5 meter deep, radiating from each corner of the center column, but not touching the corners, are the 4 main stones, 5 meters high, 2 meters wide, and 0.5 meter deep. Finishing off the build is a base, a capstone, and a plaque set a few meters away. Engraved on each side of 4 major stones, in 8 different languages, are 10 so-called guidelines for humanity, written in English, Swahili, Hindu, Hebrew, Arabic, Chinese, and Russian are the following mandates. 1. Maintain humanity under 500 million in perpetual balance with nature. 2. Guide reproduction wisely, improving fitness and diversity. 3. Unite humanity with a living new language. 4. Rule passion, faith, tradition, and all things with tempered reason. 5. Protect people and all nations with fair laws and just courts. 6. Let all nations rule internally, resolving external disputes in a world court. 7. Avoid petty laws and useless officials. 8. Balance personal rights with social duties. 9. Prize truth, beauty, love, seeking harmony with the infinite. And 10. Be not a cancer on the earth. Leave room for nature. Leave room for nature. The center stone has some very precise holes and slots cut in it. A few meters to the west of the main structure is a plaque set flush to the ground that describes the guidestones and the purpose of these cutouts, which are all astrological alignments. The slots track the annual travel of the sun, aligning with the solstices and equinoxes. The North Star, which moves very little over time, can always be seen through the hole cut in the stone. A notch in the capstone acts like a giant sundial. The noon sun falls on marks in the base plate for each day of the year. And finally, the orientation of the 4 outer stones aligned with the 18.6-year lunar declination cycle. The plaque is inscribed with the date of the monument's erection, March 22, 1980, and the phrase, quote, "Let these be guidestones to an age of reason," end quote. These words have a square around them, and the message is repeated around its edges in four ancient languages: Babylonian, Classical Greek, Sanskrit, and ancient Egyptian hieroglyphics. Also listed on this explanatory plaque are each stone dimensions in greater detail. And lastly, the plaque has a cryptic reference to a hidden treasure. It says that there is a time capsule buried 6 feet under the plaque itself, to be opened. There is no date inscribed in this area. So, is there a time capsule buried there or not? We'll probably never know. At some point, the land was given over to the United States National Park Service, so any tampering at this site is a federal offense. But that hasn't stopped graffiti artists and posers with spray cans from defacing the monument. As you can imagine, the guidestones and the message they represent have been highly controversial. 500 million people sound like a lot, but it's roughly 1/16th of the world's current population. That would mean 93.5% of the population gone. Many people point to this as genocidal occultists and say that the guidestones are telling us we need to exterminate 93.5% of the world's population. Other allegedly rational minds point to the fact that in 1980, a time when many people believed nuclear annihilation could be right around the corner, people like Brad Meltzer point out that if humanity ever gets to a time when they accept the Georgia Guidestones, the survivors may already be less than 500 million. Yoko Ono said, quote, "I want people to know about the stones. We're headed toward a world where we might blow ourselves up and maybe the globe will not exist. It's a nice time to reaffirm ourselves, knowing all the beautiful things there are in this country. And the Georgia Stone symbolized that as a stirring call to rational thinking," end quote. The guidelines on the stones deal with four main topics: population control, spirituality, environmentalism, and the establishment of a one-world government. Indeed, each of these subjects can be controversial. Some claim obvious ties to socialism. Mikhail Gorbachev commissioned the formation of a document called the Earth Charter of 2003, which closely mirrors many of the Guidestones' mandates. The largest undeniable links to the Guidestones are the Freemasons and the concept of a New World Order. This has led to the stone's nickname, the Ten Commandments of the Illuminati. R.C. Christian stated that the stones were inspired by the writings of Thomas Paine, who was one of the earliest outspoken proponents of the New World Order. The NWO is an emerging secret totalitarian concept where each sovereign nation would relinquish control of their government to a one-world government with one denomination of currency used throughout the world. This new government would be controlled by a panel made up of elitists and business executives, all of which would be billionaires. Manly P. Hall, a Canadian author, astrologer, and mystic, wrote this in 1907, quote, "When the mob governs, man is ruled by ignorance. When the church governs, he's ruled by superstition. When the state governs, he's ruled by fear. Before men can live together in harmony and understanding, ignorance must be transmuted into wisdom, superstition into an illuminated faith, and fear into love." End quote. Some conspiracy theorists claim the stones have a deep satanic origin for sun worshippers, for cult worship, and for devil worship, and even claim that human sacrifices have been performed atop the capstone 19 and a half feet up in the air. The only evidence of this is from recent drone footage showing a reddish stain on the top of a capstone. To my knowledge, no one has actually looked to confirm what the reddish substance is, but blood seems to be a common thread through several of Georgia's mysteries. 100 miles from Elberton, in Atlanta, Georgia, on a cold autumn night, a house bled. It was almost midnight on September the 8th, 1987, and Minnie Winston, age 77, got up to go to the bathroom. She didn't want to wake her husband, William, so she felt her way in the dark out into the hallway to the bathroom. Finally, she flipped on the light and was frozen by what she saw. There was a rather large pool of red liquid on the floor, and some more dripping down the wall. It looked like blood. Fearing that her husband had tried to get up before her and hurt himself immediately flashed through her mind. William Winston was 79 years old and in poor health. He needed daily dialysis. Minnie rushed to her husband to make sure he was safe. She woke him up, but he was uninjured. Tired, grumpy, and confused, but uninjured. So Minnie assumed the liquid was not blood and went back to bed. They could deal with it in the morning. But in the morning, the substance was in every room of the house. In the 22 years they had lived in the quaint one-story brick house in Fountain Drive, they had never seen anything like it. They called 911. The police found copious amounts of blood. Yes, the red substance was indeed blood. Human blood. It was pooled on the floors. It was splattered on the walls. It was even underneath the appliances. The police searched the property but found no evidence of a break-in. They did not have a pet, and no evidence of vermin could be found. The lab determined that the blood was type O, but the blood of the Winstons were both type A. The case baffled the police, but they could find no evidence that a crime had been committed. In the end, they were working under the assumption that either the Winstons or their kids were perpetrating a hoax. All of them had access to blood. William's daily dialysis treatments gave him access to it, and their daughter worked at a hospital. Minnie and William were not on very good terms with their children, and the police wondered if perhaps the Winstons hadn't vandalized their own home in attempts to garner attention from their kids. Their other theory, that their children had broken in and vandalized the house, in order to get their parents declared incompetent. But they finally decided not to pursue an investigation against either party. No homicide had been committed, and the family had endured enough embarrassment and harassment from the media. A few miles north of Atlanta is Marietta, Georgia, home of the St. James Episcopal Cemetery. The cemetery is best known as the resting place of JonBenet Patricia Ramsey, a 6-year-old beauty pageant contestant who was found dead on Christmas Day, 1996. She had been sexually assaulted and strangled. It would be another 10 years before John Mark Carr confessed to the killing of the little blonde girl who had captured America's hearts. But once again, I digress. This segment isn't about JonBenet, other than to say that she shares the cemetery with the haunted statue that some of the locals call Bloody Mary. In a slightly less visited section of St. James Episcopal Cemetery stands the statue marking Mary Minard's grave. The large marble statue depicts a woman wearing a long dress, sitting and holding two small infants, one in each arm. Very little is known about the life or the death of Mary Minard, but an obituary found in the Marietta Journal places her death on May 26, 1898. The simple tribute credited Mary as being heavily involved in the church and many of the town's charities. She died at the age of 34 and left behind a husband and 6 children. including four we call twin girls. Apparently, she passed away from a respiratory infection, probably tuberculosis, possibly contracted during childbirth. But other stories circulate around Marietta that a fire took the lives of Mary and the two infants. Several strange events have been reported around Mary's statue, including hearing disembodied footsteps, a woman crying, a baby calling for her mommy, and oddly, a puppy barking when none are seen. But the reports aren't limited to just hearing things. Some claim that if they look away from the statue and then look back, the babies in Mary's arms will change positions. But the strangest allegation of all is that the statue will, on occasion, cry tears of blood in such amounts that it pulls in the bodice of her marble dress. Other more fantastical legends are also told, like if you walk around the statue three times saying, "Mary, Mary, what happened to your babies?" that she will appear. But there are several versions of the legends. Some say you have to circle the statue 13 times, not 3. Some say that she doesn't appear, but that the ritual triggers the tears of blood. Some say that it has to be Halloween night. Some say Friday the 13th. And it may be that these legends have less to do with an actual eyewitness accounts, and more to do with the fact that the cemetery is located directly across from the Marietta Middle School. But the legends persist. To learn more about these stories, check out thelineup.com, thesecrettruthabout.com, thoughtcatalog.com, vigilantcitizen.com, and northwestgeorgianews.com. This episode was researched and written by Jeffrey Cochran. It was produced and hosted by me, Dan Sellers. You can find everything Jeff's up to at his website, adarkerworld.com. And you can find everything that we're up to at Wreak Havoc Productions at wreakhavocproductions.com. You can learn more about this show and the upcoming Carolina Haynes book at our website, the new and improved carolinahaynes.com. Don't forget to like our official Facebook page at facebook.com/carolinahaynes. You can find this show on iTunes, YouTube, Stitcher, Spotify, and iHeartRadio. Or you can listen directly from the feed at carolinahaynes.libsyn.com. You can follow us on Instagram at Recover Productions. And I'm on Twitter at Hank vs. the Undead. There's still time to check out this year's Wreak Havoc Horror Film Festival. Just visit wreakhavochorrorfilmfest.com for details. Please take a minute to subscribe to this show. Leave us a review and share it with your friends. Everyone knows that friend that loves creepy stories, so do me a favor and send it to him. You can reach out to me directly at wreakhavocproductions@gmail.com. I love hearing from listeners, so let's keep that feedback coming. We'll be back on October 31st with our special Halloween episode. Tune in then to hear more about the things that go bump in the night.